You decide to acquire your own African gray parrot. And of course, Alex comes along, very special bird. So tell us about the acquisition of Alex and a little bit about your early years, your early journal entries, what it is you write.
Well, I started by first putting in a grant proposal to do this work. I get to Purdue, and at the time the attitude was, no, we hired your husband. You're supposed to stay home, bake cookies, and make babies. And I went, I don't think so. And so it took, I could spend an hour explaining what I went through, but finally we got them to let me put in a grant proposal. Mm-hmm. And the reviews came back essentially asking me what I was smoking. Because most studies at the time were working with animals that were genetically close to humans, phylogenetically close to humans, so the great apes. Right. The last common ancestor between a parrot and a great ape was 280 million years ago. Not so good. Also, most of these studies were using animals with large brains, such as the dolphins. Parrots have the brain size of a shelled walnut. Again, not so good. Most studies using birds used pigeons. They use Skinnerian operant training. You starve an animal down to 80% of its normal body weight. You put it in a Skinner box and you go from there. And I wanted to just talk to the bird. So there were all these arguments that I wouldn't be able to maintain my professional distance. So it was quite a difficult set of reviews that came back. Mm-hmm. But I decided to persevere. I went out and we got Alex. Tested out all these different pet stores. The one criterion was to find a bird that was domestically bred, which in the 1970s was quite difficult.
Really?
Because most of them were being imported from Africa.
Sure.
That meant that one bird in 10 made it from the savanne into someone's living room. So the one criterion I had was to find a hand-raised bird. I found a pet store in the Chicago area, so we drove up. There were 8 or 9 birds in the cage. I had the fellow working with the birds pick one, because I didn't want anybody to argue that there was anything special. And he just scooped one up in a butterfly net, flipped him on his back, trimmed his beak, his wings, his toenails, and put him in a little box and said, here, $600, please. And that was how I acquired Alex.
Wow.
And then I resubmitted, I worked with Alex, and we started getting a few labels. And so I resubmitted the grant, and this time I was really lucky. I had somebody on panel who was studying birdsong. And that meant that this person, I don't know if it was a male or female, but I could tell from the reviews it was a birdsong person, recognized the striking parallels between the development of vocal communication in birds and humans. There'd been a lot of work being done on that in the early 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And said, all right, this woman isn't crazy. This may not work, but give her money for a year and we'll see what happens.
Explain a little bit about vocal cognitive ability to the audience.
Yeah. When you look at these parallels, these are mainly originally done with, again, songbirds, but we know that in both birds and humans, there's a sensitive phase during which exposure allows development to proceed most readily. So just like for humans, where you and I could learn a foreign language, but we'd sound better if we learned it as a child, the same is true of songbirds. Okay, they can learn other species songs, but they're not going to sound as good as if they learn them when they're babies, and they can learn. They both have babbling or practice periods where they experiment with the sounds that will ultimately become part of the repertoire. They need to learn the context in which to use the songs, just as children need to know, what's that versus who's that for inanimate versus animate objects. Birds need to learn what to sing for territorial defense versus mate attraction. And even at that time, we knew that there were specific parts of the brain that were responsible in both birds and humans, and that they were somewhat analogous for the learning, the storage, the production of these vocalizations.
This excerpt is brought to you by the Massachusetts School of Law, the leader of reform in legal education and a leader in multimedia education for the public. To view the full interview and for a full listing of MSL's programs, log on to mslaw.edu.